Hello, you are watching New Vision TV, and with me in the studio is Mr. Wanyama Wanga, and we are discussing about the situation in Kenya as they go back to polls. Mr. Wanyama, until yesterday, we saw Raila Odinga coming up to say, okay, it's no longer the NASA Alliance, now we are going into resistance movement. Is this going to be the national resistance movement in Kenya? And what are we expecting out of it? Because they have been in opposition, they have very many parties that came together to form the NASA Alliance. Now that he has said we are going into resistance movement, are we seeing him going with the resistance movement, with the parties that he had to the resistance movement? So what's going to happen?
Well, you're referring to the NRM. Well, I don't think NRM will be a political party in the sense, because if you look at what has been there, even NASA, and even before NASA, CORD, these have not been parties as such, but they are what you'd call political coalitions or platforms. Raila has still been running as an ODM candidate, which is his party, the Orange Democratic Movement. But when he comes together with other forums, specifically the Wiper Democratic Party of Kalonzo Musyoka and the Ford Kenya of Moses Wetangula, and then you have this time the Amani National Congress of Musalia Mudavadi, they usually get an umbrella under which they run, but they keep their individual parties. So on the ballot, you will find that actually Raila Odinga is running as the ODM, as an ODM candidate. The closest they come to being a legal entity is they sign a memorandum of understanding, which they deposit with the registrar of parties, but they don't dissolve their parties. NASA has really been a campaign umbrella. Because NASA is not a legal entity, what remains of it is really anybody's guess. It could disappear, or it could be registered into a party. We saw in 2013, Jubilee also campaigned as an umbrella. It brought together the PNU, the Party of National Unity, and the party allied to William Ruto, which was, I forget the name, but they ran as two parties under the Jubilee umbrella. When it came to 2017, they dissolved their parties and registered Jubilee as a party. So you now have Jubilee Party. But for the case for NASA, the NASA people did not dissolve their parties. Their individual parties remain. Amani remains, ODM remains, and Kalonzo Musyoka retained his Wiper Party. So whereas there's a new movement, the parties remain. For example, the people as elected in parliament are representatives of those parties. What we are seeing now is clearly a movement just to advance some goals, but not a political platform. It is basically, you'd call it a civil disobedience movement. Of course, they are going to, Raila is well known for using demonstrations. They will probably call for demonstrations either every Monday or every Friday. They are going to use demonstrations. They have promised to use boycotts. Boycotts of products from companies allied to Jubilee. A lot of these people are business people. The Uhuru family have got big companies. So they might try to call for boycotts against products from those companies. They might try to call for products on companies which cooperate with Jubilee, maybe telecoms, but I don't know if telecoms they can be successful. Uhuru is said to own a television company. They might want people to boycott that. How you see it in the market is a different case, because these are companies which, for example, if a company is providing a public good, let's say like ugali, which is consumed heavily in Kenya, a boycott might not be successful. There are companies which will suffer, but there are others which will not suffer. We'll wait and see.
How clear is it that they can identify products in Kenya and boycott them, that these products are linked to Kenyatta or Uhuru government? How clear is it? For example, if you bring it here in Uganda, We know we take Coca-Cola, we take bread, we take Pepsi, we take different products. How clear is it that I can know that this Coca-Cola is made by somebody who supports Uhuru, this Pepsi, or this hot loaf, or this sort of bread is made by somebody who supports the government? How clear is it so that this shop will completely close because people are not coming to buy products from there?
They have not even started, so we don't know how much. If, for example, a company has a lot of businesses in areas where they are very strong, and we are talking of Western Kenya and Nyanza and parts of Eastern Province and Mombasa, that company might be affected. For example, if you're a small trading block and 80% of your business is in Kisumu and they are boycotting you, you will suffer. But if you're a big national brand and the businesses in these areas are not very big, but more so your service cannot be boycotted, then you might not suffer. So it might affect different companies very differently.
Yeah, and then we see in the last 2 weeks, we've not seen Raila Odinga's deputy, Kalonzo Musyoka, and we saw him as a big principal in the elections. But in the last 2 weeks, he's not seen anywhere. He's not been at rallies, he has not been at press conferences. So has he defected to Jubilee? Has he abandoned the ship? Where has he gone? Is he worried? Where has he gone?
Kalonzo's absence has been subject to a lot of speculation. But officially, he went on a foreign trip. They say he's in Germany on private business. And the rally, I think 2 or 3 days before the election, the rally that was in Bondo, that is in Siaya County, he actually addressed via a video link to assure the people that he's still with the team. Yesterday, he's not yet back in the country, and nobody knows, until he speaks for himself, nobody knows whether he's with the new resistance or not. But we've seen MPs allied to him are still with Raila. Specifically, Johnson Muthama was at the rally yesterday, and Dan Manzo was at the rally yesterday. So it suffices to believe that he's still with them. But until he returns and pronounces himself, it's anybody's guess.
We see the elections taking place, despite the fact that the opposition had said we are not going to have elections, we are boycotting, no reforms, no elections. Now they have taken place. So what is going to happen?
I think it's a question of a calculation that legally, I think their calculation was that legally it became very difficult to stop the election. Once the Supreme Court failed to get a quorum yesterday to hold the election, you know, the law requires that the election is held in every constituency. Now, what constitutes an election in every constituency is very difficult to judge. Legally, for example, if somebody opens a ballot paper, a ballot box, and there's one vote cast, is that an election or not? Legally, somebody will say an election will have taken place. And I think the NASA people figured out that however much the boycott is going to be successful in areas where they have massive support, it is still possible for somebody to put a ballot box at a county office and throw their two ballots and say we've had two voters in this constituency, which will be legally binding. And therefore, I think they saw it futile to try and have their people have running battles with the police the whole day. There will be injuries, there will be damage to property, there will be deaths. And yet the legal process has actually taken place. So they opted to tell people to stay at home, but you still have, there's hardly been an election in large areas in Nyanza, partly because the roads are blocked, but also because the polling assistants just never turned up. But of course, in those areas, if you find the areas where you have 200 polling stations and only two have opened, I think it's still an election. Of course, any efforts to block the election, it was clear would have been successful in only four counties. Actually, some have said three and a half. that is Siaya, Kisumu, Homa Bay, and Migori. Migori is counted half because part of Migori is occupied by Non-Luo. And those are the areas where you would have had, even if NASA tried, those are the only areas where they would succeed in having a no election at all. Because the other NASA strongholds have got a mixture. The few people who will vote, if you look at Western Kenya, places like Busia, Kakamega, and Bungoma, it's very difficult to stop an election completely because there's still a small group of people who want to vote, maybe 5 to 10%, 15%, and up to 30% in Bungoma. And so it was futile to try and have battles in those areas because the voters are there. It's much easier to stop an election in areas where there are no people willing to vote at all.
Yeah, okay, so now the elections are really going on. Yes, there has been a lower voter turnout compared to August 8th, but well, still elections are going on. Is there a threshold where we would say, because Uhuru has, because the voting turnout has not reached 50% or 30% or whatever, the elections can't be considered illegal and are binding. Is there a threshold? What if 10% of the people in Kenya vote? Can we still have Uhuru declared as president?
There's no legal requirement for a threshold within which the election must be held. So even if the voter turnout is 5%, it is still sufficient. Uhuru has said he will be comfortable with 55% turnout, which I think is unlikely considering that there are boycotts in other areas. I believe the turnout could be closer to 50%, maybe 45 to 50%, but most realistically probably 40%, considering that even areas where people are not opposed to the election there, he's already won. So you'd expect a voter turnout of 40 to 50%, although he says he'll be happy with 55%. I think that is being overambitious, but I think they will come close to 50% of the voter turnout.
Yeah, so now the elections are going on, and maybe in the next one day or two we shall know who the winner is. And here there is no question, because if Odinga, the closest challenger, is not in the race, then definitely it is going to be Uhuru Kenyatta as the president, as the winner. Does the opposition have another avenue of dislodging him from State House? They have tried courts, they have not succeeded. They have tried to block the elections, they have not succeeded. Do they have any other avenue, or they still have to wait for 2022 when the next elections will take place?
The clear political opposition may not go to court, but you cannot rule out groups of civil society going to court. If you look at even the case that aborted yesterday, was not by politicians but by civil society. So you might expect civil society going to court, but I don't see the election being annulled because of fatigue in the country. The previous elections were held in August, which means campaigning started in June, and we are now moving into November. The electioneering and is hurting the economy. Everybody is tired of the electoral process. So you would expect that if anybody went to court, and it would most likely be civil society, that petition would be lost. I think people want to get back to work. The courts will just find a way around it. However, I don't see a very, very strong case, but even if it was there, the courts will find around it. There's fatigue in the country. The economy is suffering. Manufacturers are suffering. The stock market lost a lot of value, has lost a lot of value. The shilling is losing against the dollar. So you'll find people just want to go back to work.
Yes, yeah, so with the new resistance movement, Odinga and his group, they have done so much. They have demonstrated, they have had riots in Kisumu, in different parts of Kenya. They have campaigned, they have mobilized people. So with the new resistance movement, what do we expect?
He's talking of civil disobedience, but we'll wait and see. If he can sustain massive rallies for several months, that can cause a problem. It will cause a problem for the economy. It will strain the politicians. unfortunately, in parliament, he doesn't have the numbers to block legislation, unless, of course, a number of election petitions go through, and then you will have by-elections. They can try to maximize campaigns during the by-elections to try and tilt the numbers in parliament in their favor. But as the numbers are now, they're in Jubilee's favor, and so there's very little room to play. And maybe probably that is why he's going for civil disobedience, because the avenues for political change are two. You either do it in parliament or through the courts. They will, of course, try in the courts, but they don't have the parliamentary forum as of now because Jubilee has the numbers. They don't have an age limit. By the next election, Raila will be around 77. So you cannot rule him out, although how he can convince his partners that he should be the one on the ballot that time is a different, that election is almost 5 years away. And 5 years is a very long time in politics. We don't know if he can form a new configuration to try and be on the ballot at that time, but it's anybody's guess. We will wait and see.
Yeah, that is the discussion about what is happening in Kenya. We shall keep you updated on the voting process and the results as they come in. For New Vision TV, I'm Nelson Natrinda, and you can keep logged in for more news updates and what is happening. Log on to www.newvision.co.ug.